With so many podcasts out there, shows can get lost in the shuffle. That's why we implore you to check out Too Many Captains. You can find us at amoviepodcast.com.
5 unique takes on Hollywood movies and culture. Find us on Twitter at It's a Film Podcast.
Check our intellectual deep dives into theatrical films. Find us on Instagram at Too Many Captains Productions.
Unique takes on soundtracks. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/too many captains productions.
Find us at amoviepodcast.com on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and Google Play. And now, here comes a new episode of Collateral Cinema.
I'm Bo Maddox.
And I'm Biggest Dickus.
And this is Collateral Cinema. Welcome to Collateral Cinema, the only movie podcast that matters, where we focus on good movies, bad movies, and everything else in the world of cinema. We're podcasting straight from somewhere in South Texas, and yes, my friends, we are a 420-friendly podcast. So whatever you have, be it dabs, blunts, bongs, or joints, smoke it if you've got it. And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to our second ever Monty Python episode.
Hell yeah. I grew up on Holy Grail, but this was my first time watching this particular movie.
I actually kind of like it a little better than Holy Grail, to tell the truth.
I think the humor is more intelligent. I think it's more clever, but I want to say Holy Grail probably made me laugh more, but they each have their own merits.
Yeah. Well, I think that the reason for that is because Holy Grail, it's not really meant to be a real overarching narrative, you know? It's more like a sketch comedy show just with a little bit of a tangential connection between everything.
Yeah, Holy Grail is more of a series of sketches. And Life of Brian, which is the movie we're talking about today, in contrast, is actually a full, you know, beginning to end story. And I will say that it works as a story. The narrative is compelling and the characters are interesting and the humor is on point. Like I said, I think this movie is a lot more intelligent and I can respect I think the writing is better. Holy Grail just is a lot more goofy, and or maybe it's just my nostalgia flowing through. But I think that, like I said, they each have their own merit. There's different reasons why I like both, and for a lot of the same reasons I like both.
Yeah, I mean, my Monty Python, they originally started with a movie called And Now for Something Completely Different, and that in its own right was pretty much just a bunch of their sketches.
Yeah, I like to see some of their older stuff because I've heard that, you know, most of their work is going to be the sketch type stuff.
So you haven't seen like Flying Circus?
Nope. Only experience with Monty Python is Holy Grail and now Life of Brian, which I have seen more than once now in preparation for the podcast. You know, I think it does get better with each viewing.
Oh, it certainly does. And this movie had a really interesting production. What happened is that this was based off of a running gag that the Pythons would say during interviews, like that their next movie would be something along the lines of like Jesus, Life of Glory or something like that, because they were kind of jocking off of what the Patton, you know, the movie Patton, right? With George C. Scott.
Can't say that I do.
Well, in Britain, that particular movie was labeled Patton Path of Glory and or something to that effect. And
wait, in the review you showed me, they talked about that. Okay.
Yeah.
It was Lust for Glory.
Lust for Glory. There we go. Yeah. It was Lust for Glory. And they just kind of went with it from there. And it kind of morphed into a lot of different types of stories. Like one story they had, it had the like Brian being like one of the disciples of Christ, but he was just really, really bad in interpreting what Jesus was saying.
Yeah, and I definitely like the approach that they went with this, because instead of taking a shot at the belief system itself, they were taking a shot at organized religion. So, you know, Jesus himself is portrayed respectfully, I will say. I mean, he's on there on the Mount, Sermon on the Mount, you know, and it's exactly as it would be in the Bible. It's just what everybody takes away from that and what they turn it into is where chaos ensues, you know? So I kind of like the route that they ended up going with. And Jesus has a much more tangential role to the story. I mean, he's just kind of the context.
Yeah. And they also had another variation of the story that was more focused on Jesus. And it had an ending scene where at the crucifixion, Jesus's cross was made by incompetent carpenters and it kept on like falling apart and everything. But
oh no, I did hear about a particular scene that was cut with.
There's a lot of interesting scenes from this movie that were cut out, namely one regarding the Judean People's Front.
That's the one I'm referring to. And it had the leader of the Judean People's Front looked like Hitler with like the short stash.
Yeah.
And they all had the Star of David with that looks like a swastika. And what's funny is he and that symbol are actually in the movie when they show the suicide division.
Yeah. At the very end of the movie. Yeah.
Yeah. That still made its way in. They didn't get their whole scene, I guess.
it's so obvious that they were just a total fascist organization. And that's why the People's Front of Judea were just like, oh, fuck off. We're not the Judean People's Front.
We're not the Judean People's Front. We're the People's Front of Judea.
Yeah, we're going to get into that a little bit later on about the whole political angle and everything. But apparently the Pythons pretty much bought a house and moved in together when they were writing this. And they all pretty much contributed equally. Like, I mean, I believe Eric Idle, he contributed a lot more of the actual music and everything.
That's what I've heard, is yeah. That he's more involved in more of the musical stuff.
Yeah, and Terry Gilliam, he was the one that was responsible for that crazy-ass little non sequitur with the aliens and everything.
That was him?
that's Terry Gilliam behind that.
I love that part. You know what? That has Terry Gilliam all over it, because looking at all of the animations that he does, I mean, that really just fits in completely with that whole aesthetic.
It's beautiful, man. I mean, and if you've ever seen any of his other movies, I mean, he's a very well-known director in his own right. I mean, he made the movie Brazil, and that particular scene, it has a little bit of it's kind of prophetic as to what he did in that movie.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, but they moved into this house. They all just got together, wrote this movie. And like I said, they went through the different variations of the script. But, I mean, the final script, they had a lot of trouble getting studio backing for. Like, EMI, which was the original production company that they were going to release this under, they pretty much just said, like, there's no way we're going to make our money back on this.
Yeah.
and they literally read the script like a week before they were going to start production. They're actually going to start filming and everything. So they had a little bit of a problem finding backing for this. And none other than George Harrison of the Beatles. He stepped in and pretty much saved this fucking movie. I mean,
doesn't he make a cameo too?
He does. Yeah, he's somewhere in this movie, I think, with the People's Front of Judea somewhere. And what's interesting is, I believe, I don't know if it was George Harrison or not, but if you know anything about Alejandro Jodorowsky, like he pretty much made Holy Mountain because of, I forget if it was George Harrison or Paul McCartney, but one of the Beatles paid for that movie as well. And
oh,
if
really?
You know anything about that, that is an insane mindfuck movie.
Okay.
But George Harrison, he pretty much put his house up for, he refinanced it. He pretty much sold it. And also an office building that he owned.
Wow.
Yeah. And it was all for this movie. And, you know, the world is better off for it. So thank you, George Harrison.
Yeah.
Rest in peace.
Dude, that is awesome to hear that he was involved in that. And I remember looking that up and finding that out online and also in the review, one of the reviews that you sent me. So, and, yeah. and it's funny because I think that Monty Python is often compared to the Beatles, you know, but in the comedy film world.
Yeah, they're pretty much the Beatles of comedy. Very much so. I mean, especially with that very uniquely British flair to their comedy.
Yeah, it's very British. And sometimes it is a little bit hard to get into if you're watching this as a first time viewer and you've never seen, you know, Holy Grail or Life of Brian. That's why I said it gets better with every viewing, because once you understand the eccentricities of British humor, the movie just comes across so much better.
It really does. I mean, I have long watched a lot of British comedy. I mean, not just Monty Python, but even more recent stuff like Look Around You, which I really, really recommend. And also, I don't know if you've ever heard of Garth Marenghi's Dark Place.
Can't say
oh,
they...
my God. You are missing out so much. This is shit that came out on Adult Swim. There was a period where Adult Swim was showing a lot of British television. And Look Around You is pretty much like this science documentary show, but it's just really, really funny and kind of weird and everything. It starts off one way, almost like a documentary, and then the second series, it's more like a science variety hour, kind of. But it's made by Peter Serafinowicz, who is himself a giant in British comedy. And also, I don't know if you've ever heard of The Mighty Boosh.
No.
Oh, my goodness. The Mighty Boosh is very, very out there. Real out there okay. humor. It's even more out there than Monty Python's humor.
Well, Bo, I mean, you know full well that you're introducing me to more obscure works in the world of cinema. I will say Monty Python, at least, is pretty fairly well known. Most people have seen Holy Grail, I feel like, that I talk to, but it still does have kind of that cool classic vibe.
I would go so far as to say that there's probably not a whole lot of people who have really seen Life of Brian.
I mean, yeah, I will say I don't think a lot of people have seen this one.
Yeah, they've seen Holy Grail. Everybody's seen Holy Grail. But not enough people have seen Life of Brian, and that's a travesty because I really think this is the superior movie.
I could definitely see where you would apply that. There are parts of this that is, I mean, it's a better developed story. The narrative is more cohesive and it manages to be funny all the same. And like I was saying before, that the way that the jokes are written is just done so much more intellectually. I mean, there's just different layers that are packed into the humor where, you know, even if you're not like on the floor laughing, which a lot of this you will be, you're at least going to appreciate the depth behind it. And you're going to be like, yeah, okay, that was pretty clever. But then there's moments where they just take cheap shots and use things like lisps. And it's still funny.
I think a big part of that is that they had an actual kind of agenda for this movie. You know,
yeah.
they wanted to kind of attack certain, you know, closed modes of thought, especially more dogmatic modes of thought, like ideology and religious fundamentalism and whatnot. So,
yeah.
I mean, it's coming from a place where, you know, they're trying to make a statement, more or less. And that's kind of what's lacking in Holy Grail. I mean, Holy Grail is a great movie. It's absolutely hilarious. I laugh my ass off all the time watching that movie. But this movie is much more stimulating.
Yeah, that's probably the best way to describe it, as stimulating, is it really makes you think. You know, you've got this moment where Brian is believed to be the Messiah, and he's got this mass of people following him, and he's telling them all to be individuals, and they go, "We're individuals."
It's like that scene right there best encapsulates what that type of hardcore dogmatic adherence is like.
Yeah, because what it does in satirizing organized religion is it sort of exaggerates it, and it puts it in a visually distinctive way that you can understand, okay, that's batshit insane. But then you step back and you think about it, and it's actually not that far from reality. Is it really that exaggerated? I mean, other than the time frame over which this happens, people certainly aren't that dogmatic. It's just usually it takes them longer than a few minutes to get there.
Well, I mean, it happens really, really quickly to Brian in this movie. I mean, one second he's running away from the Romans, And then the next minute, he's pretty much the figurehead of another messianic movement. And this is in a place where Jesus exists. Jesus is preaching. I mean, the Sermon on the Mount is in this movie.
Right, right. Like I was saying earlier, and I think what's funny about that is that, you know, they're not even necessarily going to go in and take shots at the belief system. They're not going to mock that. They're just mocking the way that people treat organized religion, you know?
What I think is really interesting is how they pretty much just gloss over Jesus, and mainly it's because they all agreed that we can't make fun of Jesus. It's like he actually had some great ideas. It's like he was a nice fellow. We can't go off on him like that.
I kind of agree there. You know, it's kind of like regardless of what you believe, I mean, the writings, you know, at least what's attributed to having been said by Jesus is some pretty good stuff about grace and forgiveness and, you know, turning the other cheek. And it's some good stuff. So that's, you know, and to me, I feel like that's just humanity shining through. I think we have our moments, even in messes like religion, but not to get too deep here, but I like that. Yeah, that's pretty much left intact. It's just the fanaticism, you know, and it's the misinterpretation.
And that fanaticism is really undercut with the gathering of that following that Brian just finds himself in the middle of all of a sudden. You know, like there's the one faction that's saying, that lady is saying, no, follow the gourd, trust the gourd. And then like he leaves his shoe behind. And then there's another faction that starts splintering off over his shoe. Like his following is already starting to show schisms. It's happening.
Exactly. We're seeing where like sects happen in a religion. And we're seeing where different things that are completely ambiguous and may not have had any intention whatsoever are just subjected to all different kinds of interpretation, you know,
definitely
over something as simple as a shoe. And it's funny because it makes you step back and realize when you're watching that scene, oh shit, isn't that kind of like what it's like in real life? And I think that there are definitely even some Christians that can watch this movie and enjoy the message that is actually going through here. Cause again, I don't think it's necessarily offensive. I mean, aren't Monty Python on record saying something like it's not blasphemous, it's heresy, but it's not blasphemous?
Oh, it's very much heretical. I mean, it is pretty much poking the organized aspect of religion straight in the eye.
Yeah. Which, you know, and to be fair, most Christians today that I know are people that aren't fans of the idea of, you know, of organized religion. They're kind of just like, yeah, well, I like my faith. I just, you know, I'm not a big on the whole organized religion thing. And God, it's what a shit show. Hey. And we basically see how these things start, you know?
The actual plot of this movie is really, really good in its own right. I mean, the script is solid in so many ways, and a lot of that goes back to just the dialogue and wordplay that Monty Python is just so well known for.
Yeah.
Like, for instance, this particular line from that scene where Brian is cornered by all of his believers after he slept with Judith. Like, his mom straight up comes out and says, he is not the Messiah. He is a very naughty boy. It's like, that was actually voted one of the funniest movie lines of all time.
Really?
And I can totally see why. It's so ridiculous. I mean, she's just this typical overbearing mother, and she's having to face this crowd that's decided to just coalesce around her son. And she's like, he's not the Messiah. He's a naughty boy. He's just Brian.
Yeah. and it's funny because, you know, it's almost as if she doesn't even completely grasp the seriousness of the situation. You know, she's just like,
even in the beginning, just, whenever she encounters the three wise men who have followed the star where Jesus is supposed to be. I mean, she's very flippant about it then. Like, she's even shooing them out after they show up and they're like, we're here to see the Son of God. And the minute that they say that they have gifts, she's like, well, come on back in and everything.
And that's Terry Jones, right?
Yeah, that's Terry Jones playing Mrs. Cohen. And he is
drag
fantastic in that role. Well, he always did the drag scenes in Monty Python, and he's the most memorable part of that group specifically for that.
Yeah, You know what's funny is I like that, for instance, like Graham Chapman is being, you know, even though he's the protagonist of the story, he's kind of the straight man in this situation. And he's portraying more of just kind of a regular guy. He's not an eccentric personality, you know, and he actually excels at that. And it's funny to see that.
What's notable about that is at the time he was actually a raging alcoholic, and that made filming with him quite difficult, needless to say.
I could see that, though. I really could.
Yeah, but the Pythons all said that the biggest reason why he was always front and center like that is he was, quite frankly, the better actor out of all of them. Like he actually just kind of knew how to really take command of the screen and of each scene he was in.
Well, yeah, I mean, and he also did King Arthur and Holy Grail, and he did that pretty well. You know, yeah, he's just kind of there. He's the front man. You know.
Yeah, he was very authoritative in that role, and you know, it makes sense to put him at the center of everything like that.
And even in that movie, he's not the character with the most amount of personality, you know?
Oh, no, not
at
all.
But he is the lead. He also does Biggest Dickest, right?
Oh, yeah, he's Biggest Dickest. He is wonderful in that role as well. Like, we'll get to that here in a little bit. The setting of the movie is really interesting because this is Judea occupied by Rome, by the Roman Empire. And in many ways, this is probably a more accurate portrayal of Judea at this particular time in history than any other movie. Probably not till The Passion of the Christ.
Yeah, no, that's true. Didn't they re-release this movie in the theaters when Passion of the Christ came out?
They did. They totally did. And that was just perfect. That is just a perfect business sense right there to do that.
But you want to know something funny? We actually showed clips of this movie in my Latin class in high school. So I have a little bit of experience because I've seen both the Latin lesson scene and what have the Romans ever done for us scene. We saw both of those in Latin.
Yeah, man, the Latin lesson scene is so great, you know, because it's so hilarious. I mean, it starts off as just a scene of vandalism, and then he's just getting this lesson in Latin, and it's almost like the movie grinds to a halt right there, but it's still so perfectly funny that it doesn't really chop up the flow of the movie at all.
No, in fact, that's an example of the more intelligent humor that's in this movie. Actually, both of those examples, I'll say, because, you know, it's the complete opposite reaction. It's really funny how they can set up humor like this without a big punchline, you know, like it just is what it is. And you're sitting here and you're watching this happen and he's just giving him the lesson and it goes on and on and on, you know.
Well, the thing about that is that the Pythons kind of had an aversion to the punchline part of any type of comedic setup. It's like, look, we like setting up the premise, we like ad-libbing, we like just going with it, but once you get to a punchline, it just loses the point, you know?
Exactly. That's why I brought that up, because I'd heard that too, you know? And so, you know, you have these awesome jokes. And then, of course, there is the notorious scene where they're talking about, you know, what have the Romans ever done for us? This is what we want out of Rome. And then they mention, oh, well, they, you know, what about sanitation and
the aqueducts?
Aqueducts and education and safer streets and lack of pollution and, you know, roads. And then they go on to this list. And besides all of these things, what have the Romans ever done for us?
Bro, peace? It's like, oh, peace, shut up. Fucking John Cleese, you know, he's always
John Cleese
the one.
Is great.
He's always the one yelling in Monty Python sketches.
And so. He's just like, oh, yeah, that goes without saying. We obviously know that.
But back to the setting of Judea, I mean, I really like how they set up the marketplace. I like the fact that you see crucifixes all over the place, which, you know, just undercuts the fact that, you know, crucifixion was a very normal part of life under Roman rule.
No, it was. Like, that was the whole point is it was actually a very standard form of execution. I think even remembering it, you know, learning in Latin, it wasn't even like the highest level of punishment, you know?
Not at all.
And I love how all the characters of this movie seem to want to undermine it too. Like, that's the running gag. Oh, crucifixion, that first offense. Oh, that isn't too bad. It's a doll. You know?
Oh, yeah. That scene with John Cleese as a centurion and the old man that's hiding the people's front of Judea is just pure genius, honestly.
Yeah.
And in a way, I don't really know who that actor is, but that character kind of steals the show a little bit there. His timing with John Cleese is just right on.
Yeah, it really is. And I'm old and my ears don't work.
My nose is knickered. My ears are dull.
Every time.
He's just trying to put up a layer of bullshit.
I like how they all, like, when they're going to, like, hide themselves, like, there's the one guy who just hides himself under a fucking sheet. Like,
it's also obvious, and he sends in all those Centurions, and they just, oh my lord.
I love the animation that I've seen as they're all, like, just running through, you know, they speed it up.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you're just watching them, like, go through the door and then walk out the doorway.
How do you think the Romans look in comparison with the citizens of Judea? How do they kind of compare?
I mean, they're authoritative. They're the soldiers that are maintaining order in the city. I mean, I think that much is set up for us.
But what's interesting is that in many ways, the Roman centurions, they're kind of always in the background, just kind of looking at all this craziness going on in front of them. And they just look like, God damn, these fucking Judeans. It's like, Jesus Christ. like there's that stoning scene. I mean, I don't think those are necessarily Roman soldiers, but those soldiers, I mean, after John Cleese's character is stoned, they're just like, these fucking idiots. My God.
Yeah.
And in the biggest dickest scene, it's the Roman centurions are the ones that are snickering their ass off at Pontius Pilate.
That is what makes that scene so funny, is that, like, you look in their faces and they want so desperately to laugh.
And I'm sure,
and
that's
such 100%, a juvenile joke.
I'm sure that's real laughter as well. I'm sure they're really trying to keep themselves from ruining the fucking scene.
Do you have a problem with my friend whose name is Biggest Dickus?
Biggest Dickus.
Do you know what his wife is called? Incontinentia buttocks.
Damn it. Now, this movie doesn't really just focus on religion when it comes to dogmatic adherence. It also kind of lays into left-wing politics a little bit, right?
Yeah, it really does. With the, like we were mentioning earlier, the various subgroups of, you know, the Judean People's Front, the People's Front of Judea.
And I said it before, and I'll say it again here. If you know anything about working or organizing with any type of left-wing militant political group, a lot of that shit can be really true. Not all of them, but some of them. It can actually have some truth in television there, a little bit, so to speak.
Yeah, because, I mean, you look at it from the outside and it's like, oh yeah, these people want the same thing, and they even came up with the exact same idea in the exact same night, right? But they're hung up over these small differences that they have between each other. And I think that's just so perfect for, I mean, almost any political organization if you really think about it.
Yeah, but it's something that is peculiar to left-wing politics. I mean, take it from someone who is kind of from that side of the spectrum. I mean, it can really be like that, especially online.
No, I've seen some of that as well. And I definitely drew a lot of those parallels while watching the movie. You know, it was just funny to, again, they're taking an idea, something that, you know, may not even be that exaggerated in the scene. But when you put it under a microscope and you kind of have it in this comedic context, it really pokes at all the little holes.
Indeed. But, I mean, especially how it really compares the dogmatic elements of political ideology and religious fundamentalism. The parallels are pretty much very well drawn there, as far as I can tell.
No, definitely. I mean, I was watching it and I thought the same thing. Like, this really hit close to home. Like, I know exactly what's going on. And it's an obvious conclusion, and it's meant to be drawn, obviously. I mean, you watch it for the first time and you're like, okay, I understand exactly what they're doing here. But, you know, the more that they get into it and the more that they dive into the joke and continue with the setup, the funnier it gets and the more real it gets.
Now, another interesting thing about this movie is that it was pretty much made to kind of rag on the different types of tropes that you saw in biblical epics at the time. Because before this, like, biblical epics, they were presented in a particular way that's very grandiose, like kind of like the actors are very aware that they're in a biblical epic. I mean, I think the Pythons were straight up saying that we wanted to subvert that. We didn't want the characters to be like speaking in this particular biblical dialect. We just wanted them to sound like what we normally sound like when we're bullshitting.
Yeah, and that is very Python. You know, you just kind of have this scene that's set up in a way and the characters are talking like how people normally talk. And you'll spend like a good 5 minutes or so on something that's completely, what's the word? Not monotonous, but just normal, you know, just pedestrian. There
very
you go.
Pedestrian. That's the word there I was... you go.
Everyone knows the glorious story of the child born in a faraway manger. Well, this isn't that story. This is Monty Python's all-new Life of Brian.
They call Brian.
He was born into the golden age of Roman rule.
Do we have any crucifixions today?
139, sir. Special celebration.
It was a time of miracles.
I was blind, and now I can see. Oh!
Friendly persuasion. And gracious invaders. But there was just one thing on everyone's mind.
Sex, 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 that's all they think about it.
Oh dear.
In those days, getting stoned wasn't against the law. It was the law. And things looked bad.
The Romans.
For the people of Jerusalem.
Still a few crosses left.
Until Brian dropped in. He was a born leader.
Brothers, brothers, we should be struggling together.
We are.
A potential martyr.
What will they do to me? Oh, you'll probably get away with crucifixion.
Crucifixion?
Yeah, first offense.
And his mother's joy.
You mean telling them?
They think I'm the Messiah, Mum.
Ah! The Messiah!
There's no Messiah in here. There's a mess, all right, but no Messiah.
And now, it's up to Brian to deliver a despairing nation from the throes of oppression. Tough luck, Jerusalem. This is the life of Brian. Just when you thought you were saved. It's Monty Python's Life of Brian. He wasn't the Messiah. He was a very naughty boy.
Terrific race, the Romans. Terrific.
And then it gets into kind of this absurdity, you know, because then they're just reveling in it.
Oh, man. I mean, and it's great whenever they revel in it because those are usually the scenes that have the most comedic flow to it.
Yeah, they do. And you get a feeling like a lot of it is even maybe ad-libbed. You know, like this is not strict to script.
I wouldn't be surprised if some of the biggest dickest scene is ad-libbed.
Yeah. Or the preacher, you know, that one of the prophets, you know, who's just going on and he's saying the most like generic, ambiguous thing.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
I'm pretty sure, you know,
so generic, so vague. It's like everybody is just kind of looking at him like, wait, what the fuck is going on here? What is this dude talking about?
So even though this, it has an overarching plot, right? We still have elements of the sketch in there. You know, you've got the cast of Monty Python. And they're just kind of doing their thing.
Yeah. And I mean, there's six people playing 40 characters in this fucking movie.
Yes.
I mean, and they bring life to each and every one of them. I mean, from the members of the People's Front of Judea to the Judean People's Front to Pontius Pilate and the way that the Roman upper class or Roman statesmen are portrayed. I mean, it's so fucking amazing how they really nailed it.
Yeah. And I like how each one of them plays so many different types of eccentric personalities, you know, like John Cleese does both Reg, the, you know, leader of the People's Front of Judea and also the Roman centurion.
Oh yeah. And what other roles did he play there? He also played the rabbi at the stoning scene.
Yeah.
I'll never forget the first time I saw that scene. Oh my God, that shit just made me laugh so hard, especially near the end when they just clobbered him with that ginormous fucking stone.
Which comes out of where? You know, speaking of which, what makes that scene so funny too is the anachronistic context of it.
Yeah.
You know, because they're treating it like this is something that you go do, you know, we're going to go to the stoning. Do you want to buy a stone? Do you want to buy a fake beard?
Yeah. That's the other interesting thing about that is that the crowd is most all women dressed up like men. It's made so obvious. Like at very first, they're all getting riled up and you hear them speak in women's voices. Then they lower their voices like, yes, yeah.
Yes.
It's so perfect. And then just the whole sequence leading up to the rabbi getting stoned is brilliant. I mean, all of this is just happening because this old man just said his meal was good enough for Jehovah.
Right? Which is funny because, you know, they make such a big deal out of it. And then he starts saying Jehovah.
Well, it just goes back into what they were critiquing there, the whole adherence to closed dogmatic modes of thought. I mean,
yeah.
The entire reason that they're there is because of something really stupid. This dude just said that his meal was good enough for God.
Right. It's so funny, the levels that we go to. I mean, was that ever intended by anyone that actually wrote the Bible? Did Muhammad ever intend to never be visually depicted? You know?
Yeah, exactly. And just seeing how quickly everybody was turning on everybody in that scene was quite amazing. Like, there's like two or three people that are stoned there and even some false starts.
You're right.
And John Cleese is just like, all right, who threw it? Who threw the stone? Yeah.
I love just how like nonchalant they are about it too, which I mean, I guess would be for the time probably fairly accurate. I mean, if it was an everyday thing, but it's just really funny, you know, seeing it in today's context.
Exactly. I mean, that scene is a favorite of mine. And
I think it's that they, like you said, they don't talk like Epic. Or they don't even talk like they would back from that time. They talk like we do.
Yeah, exactly. It's a very modern sensibility.
There's this juxtaposition that's built, you know, between the setting and the characters, or at least the way that they speak and they carry themselves, you know. And you've even got some progressive thoughts like transgender, you know.
Yeah, it's really interesting how they approached that. I mean, of course, Reg is incredulous to it. He's like, you want to make babies?
You know, it's funny, too, because I don't know if that scene would fly today. But if you think about it, it actually is kind of a progressive win because all of the characters just accept it. And they call the character by what is
Lorena or something like that? That was
Lorena. Yeah. They call her Loretta, you know?
Yeah,
and
they
for the
do.
Rest of the movie, she's Loretta. And they just kind of accept it. You know, it's funny because they get hung up on like, well, no, you can't have babies. It's just not biologically possible.
Yeah, yeah.
It doesn't matter whether...
Isn't Reg being a little turfy there, kind of? You'd be total turf there, man. Turf. Like, damn, is J.K. Rowling going to show up out of nowhere?
Okay, come on.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, babies. Yeah, I went there. That's right. That's your goddess, Ash.
Oh my God. Okay, you know what? I can separate a work from the author, okay?
Okay.
I can say that I enjoy the Harry Potter series because it was a fundamental part of my childhood. I will say that J.K. Rowling is an intelligent person who wrote a good story, but she happens to be a person with some misled ideals. And that sucks. It sucks to see your heroes go down, but you know, she knows what she's doing and she's continuing to do it. So I can't feel sorry for her.
Yeah. Well, I just had to go there, you know.
You had to go there. I know.
Yeah, no. Now let's talk about that ending scene. It actually kind of has many layers to it. I mean, first you have the crucifixion march, which is, once again, everybody's just so nonchalant about it, especially the Romans. I mean, like, he's just so chipper about it. It's like, one cross each, go out to the left, line up behind the back.
I like how that one, too.
Yeah, Eric Idle, like, he just totally confounds him. He's like, oh, freedom.
I'm not here for the cross. And he's like, okay, go ahead. No, I'm fucking with you. I really.
it makes sense that character is so nonchalant about it because he's constantly saved.
Yeah, they do mention that later.
Yeah, it's mentioned later. It's like, yeah, my brother usually comes and gets me. It makes me wonder if that was actually a thing with crucifixions, you know?
They weren't, like, nailed there. I mean, they were just tied up by ropes. It doesn't seem like it would be that hard for someone to get someone down if they wanted to. I mean, I assume that in reality that was guarded or whatever, but...
Oh, I'm sure that some people slipped through every now and again. I would imagine so.
It does add some context to the gag earlier in the film where he goes, you know, crucifixion, first offense. And we all laugh like, ha, 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 obviously, you know, you die when you're once you're crucified. There's no first offense about it. But then it ties it back in. And it's like, OK, well, yeah, I guess people could be saved. So they took what was originally a joke. And actually, there's a reason that could happen.
Yeah. But, I mean, crucifixion takes a good goddamn long time to kill you. I mean, in the story of the crucifixion, it took Jesus how many days to finally die?
3 days.
At least 3 days, yeah?
Or, no, hold on, no, he was dead for 3 days.
He was dead for three, yeah.
I think it took him like a day to die, yeah. He was up there for like a day.
Yeah, but it makes sense that if somebody gets to you right in time, I mean, they can just get you down there and take you on your way. I mean, yeah, you probably got yourself a beating. I mean, if the Passion of the Christ is anything to go off of, which, yeah, that's kind of dubious, but... But yeah, nobody got their ass beat on the procession to the crucifixion hill.
No, you know what's funny is I like how there's this one dude who like steps in to grab the cross.
And oh the yeah,
dude just runs.
He just gets fucked over, and Eric Idle is like, "Ha, serves you right." So perfect. And then when they're finally putting everybody up on the crosses, and everybody is up and everything, it's like that's when. All of the other characters come out of the woodwork to face Brian, and none of them are coming to save him. None of them.
I like how he has every attempt at a rescue opportunity. I remember seeing that at one point. I was like, oh, I mean, he's got two different ways to go out here. He's got, you know, they're going to pull him back because the people voted for Brian and the People's Front of Judea are coming in, you know. And one by one, every single person that could have been an opportunity for Brian to leave is not, you know, it's really funny.
Well, the entire reason that he's not released by the Romans is because of the People's Front of Judea. They come and see him first, and they just read their proclamation, like clap for him and everything, and then sing for he's a jolly good fellow.
You know? No, because they don't let him go because the other guy takes it, says that he's Brian of Nazareth.
Yeah, and but the reason that he doesn't hear them is because he's yelling and screaming at them, you bastards, you bloody bastards. He's just going off on the People's Front of Judea, and he doesn't hear the Roman centurion say, where's Brian? Who here is Brian? And of course, everybody's going to say, I'm Brian. But Eric Idle was just the first one to say it.
Yeah. It's kind of funny, actually, is that I was watching that. And I was like, is that the system that they use? Whoever's the first to say, yeah, I'm Brian.
Yeah, seems a bit convoluted, right?
But I suppose if you really are Brian, you are going to be the first to hear your name and perk up and think, yeah, that's me. Before someone else a split second later thinks, oh, wait, I could pretend to be him. So,
yeah, but the whole thing is that, you know, Brian was distracted. Brian was distracted. He was going off on the People's Front of Judea.
Yeah. And then Judith comes for him, and then the Judean People's Front comes for him.
Oh man, the Judean People's Front was great.
I love how they're like they're Nazi Jews. Like what?
Oh yeah, it's all kinds of screwy, man.
That's all kinds of fucked up, man.
But they just having that little compartment to open up just to stick their blades into their chest. That is just priceless. Absolutely priceless.
They're like, this is the suicide division. They just come up to someone and they just come up to people and stab themselves. Like, what? Why?
But then the nail in the coffin is Miss Cohen shows up, Brian's mom, and she just chastises him.
How dare you be crucified?
She's more like, go ahead, be crucified. I don't care.
Go ahead, see what you do to your old mom.
I mean, I'm going to legit say I think that Miss Cohen is the best character in the movie, probably.
Yeah,
probably
she
is. Next to Pilot. Brian himself is good as well.
He is, like I said, he's just the straight man, and it's just he is the audience's link, as a protagonist should be, the audience's link into the scenario, into, you know, this bizarre situation with these characters. Who are all these characters?
Oh, man, I mean, with Pilot... I love that they gave him the whole, you know, he's unable to pronounce his R's shtick, the Elmer Fudd shtick.
The lisp.
Yeah. No, no. Biggest Dickus has the lisp. Pontius Pilate cannot say his R's at all. He's like, what did he squadja? And then right. near the end of the movie, like, all the Jewish people who came to see that, they're just, like, totally ragging on him. By the end of the day, they're just on their backs laughing their asses off at him.
Well, it's like the impressive clergyman in The Princess Bride.
Exactly.
You know, you take something that we're all familiar with. This shouldn't be that funny. It's an overdone joke. And yet you put it in a context that does make it funny because it's just there.
Well, it's especially, you know, giving that little quirk to a pretty important figure in the story of Jesus' crucifixion. You know, Pontius Pilate, like, if you remember from the story, you know, he didn't want to execute Jesus. He was like, there's no evidence here. It's like, what the fuck are you people even bringing him to me for?
Yeah, I remember that. And they want, like, they sent out, you know, he's like, here's Barnabas. And they're like, free Barnabas. What?
Free Barnabas.
I love that they're just fucking with him the whole time. You know what's funny is it seems like he's not even aware of his own speech impediment.
No, he's 100% not aware. Neither is Biggest Dickus. They're just not aware of it at all.
No. Biggest Dickus. And then they do the same thing to him.
Honestly, I'm going to say this right now. It's brilliant just bringing Biggest Dickus into the movie like that. You know, actually just making him a character.
Yeah.
I mean, that was brilliant in its own right. I mean, you bring up Biggest Dickus and then you actually bring him and he's even more of a pompous ass than Pontius Pilate is.
Yeah. And he just, it's just funny. Like Biggest Dickus is just laying there and he looks like a complete dick.
Yeah. And he is a total dick. He
you
is
can just tell, dick. You know, just the way he's just fucking sitting there.
Yeah, he's just sitting there eating his fruit, just all flamboyantly and everything. And then he thinks that he could actually, you know, help convey, you know, what Pontius Pilate is trying to say to the Judean people.
Yes.
And then he just gets laughed at worse. It's worse. I absolutely love it, man.
I love how the mass completely, you know, it's funny, in an instant, they completely forget their dogma. Yeah. They don't even, it doesn't even occur to them to free Brian until, you know, because they're just going off on this joke until Judith comes in, you know, but
yeah,
it's just funny because there's another point right there is how easily people give in to their own, you know, selfish tendencies and completely forget the religion that they try to adhere themselves to.
Yeah. And speaking of that, there was quite the uproar over this movie. Like, I mean, this movie was actually banned in several countries. It was banned in Norway. That was actually a marketing point for them. This is the movie that was so funny. It was banned in Norway.
Banned in Norway. Yeah, I saw that.
It was also banned in Germany for quite a while, apparently.
They would do that.
Yeah, it was banned in Ireland for a year.
It's crazy to think that in 78 or 79.
It was 79.
79, that they were pushing these kinds of boundaries, you know?
Oh, yeah. And this is like after something like The Exorcist came out, which was another movie that created that type of religious uproar. And before that, Rosemary's Baby.
Yeah. Well, even just the premise of this movie, you don't have to watch it like as soon as you know what it's about. It's like, yeah, you know, because I'd heard about it before. And when I, you know, first heard about it, I actually was religious. And I was kind of like thinking in the back of my head, do I want to watch this? Like, this sounds like really, what's the word?
Blasphemous.
I mean, it sounds really blasphemous. Yeah.
Yeah, but of course it had that Streisand effect to it where it kind of made the movie a little more notorious and had more people actually watch it.
But I'll go out and say that, like, even if you are someone that's a Christian, you know, and practicing, go to church, I still think that there's going to be a lot of value to be had here. I think you can still find this funny, you know, because, again, it's not necessarily offensive towards, you know, the idea of a belief system. It's just the links that people will go to, you know.
Exactly.
But I like that, you know, Brian in the movie ultimately has, you know, the significant advice. I mean, that is an actual, like, good advice. He's like, you know, just be individual, you know?
Yeah. That's the undercurrent of this movie, is individualism, more or less.
Now, you listen here. He's not the Messiah. He's a very naughty boy. Now, go away.
Who are you?
I'm his mother, that's who.
Behold his mother! Behold his mother! Hail to thee, mother of God! Blessed art thou, Hosanna! All praise to thee, now and always!
Now, like that. He's not coming out, and that's my final word. Now, shovel!
No!
Did you hear what I said?
Yes!
Oh, I see. It's like that, is it?
Yes!
Then you can see him for 1 minute, but not 1 second more. Do you understand?
Yes!
Promise?
But Mum, Judith.
Can't leave that Welsh tart alone.
I don't really want to.
Start wrapping things up here, and usually we give our final thoughts, but here let's do something a little different. What are some of your favorite scenes from this movie? I mean, we've touched on a few of them, but what are like your two most liked scenes here?
Ooh, okay. Well, I will say that I do really enjoy the Latin lesson scene. There's just a lot of comedy value there. There's a lot of, it's very intelligent. It's clever. Like you said, it brings the movie just to a complete halt, but it's funny.
And they literally pretty much make him do a chalkboard gag.
Yeah.
Like, they literally have him say it over and over and over again, write it up on the wall.
Yeah. As for number two, I will say, I think the scene where, you know, he's like, crucifixion, take your cross and go.
Yeah.
You know, and Eric Idle's character is just like, no, I'm free. I'm just fucking with you.
That scene is fantastic, man. It's fantastic. Well, the first scene that comes to mind for me is the most obvious one, the ending. You know,
yeah.
That song, always look on the bright side of life. Like, that is such a classic song, and I think that in this day and age, this is something that I was really thinking about earlier. This movie is even more pertinent now than it ever was. I mean, this is a movie that is talking about things that are happening right now, especially with supporters of a certain deposed president, you know, who we will not name right now.
You must not be named.
Yeah. But yeah, you're seeing some parallels there, you know, especially with dogmatic adherence, the schisms and everything. I mean, it's the same whether you're talking about politics or religion. And that scene right there, though, it ends up being so optimistic. It kind of makes you feel like everything's going to be all right, you know, and this is kind of the movie that we need right now.
Okay, I definitely see what you're saying, because regardless of, you know, where we're headed, even prior to the election, I was kind of like, we're fucked either way. We either get 4 more years of the orange bastard or we have to deal with some fucking militant ass supporters, but always look on the bright side of life. I mean, even if you're completely fucked, okay, I'm going to hang here and die in a horrible, agonizing way. But you know what?
Everything is fine. Always look on the bright side of life. I mean, it ends with that level of optimism. And that's uplifting. This is a very uplifting movie.
What's funny is I think that part was just kind of like, I think they said like, couldn't think of anything else better. We just left it off at that.
That's literally how it went, you know, and you know, Eric Idle, he was the one who wrote that. Like, he was pretty much just singing that melody and everything, and it just kind of stuck. So,
yeah. You know, and I don't know why I would have expected a Monty Python film to end any differently than that way.
Yeah. But scene number two for me is the biggest, dickest scene. I mean, there's just so much joy there. Like, you could totally tell that everybody is trying their damnedest not to just bust out laughing and fuck up, or at least bust out laughing out of time and fuck up the scene, you know?
Or you know what? I think I would have picked one of those two scenes, actually. Or, well, sorry, that scene in one of my two scenes, now that I think about it.
Yeah.
That one really did stick out to me and make me laugh a whole lot.
I mean, between that and the meetings what, the People's Front of Judea?
Like, yes, I mean, every single one.
Every single one of those. I mean, in reality, I mean, all of these scenes are great. Like, I have the movie on right now, and I'm at the alien scene, which, yeah, that's another great notable scene that we talked about earlier. Terry Gilliam's scene right here. It's like, that's also great as well. It's non sequitur. It's just so out there. But I guess that's where we're going to go ahead and end the show. Ash, go ahead and do your plugs, man.
All right. Well, Collateral Gaming, we were supposed to have our episode out on The Last of Us Part 2. We're actually postponed and have, like all of our episodes, it's going to be a two-part. So there's going to be a part one and part two of The Last of Us Part 2. But we'll be releasing both parts simultaneously around the time that I was going to release the second part. So that's the only postpone, is we're releasing both of those together. I did just today record an episode on Spider-Man Miles Morales. It was a game launch episode, and God, that game was incredible. And we're doing another game launch episode this month on Hyrule Warriors Age of Calamity, which I've been playing the hell out of. It's awesome. And next month, you can look forward to our anniversary special on Skyrim and our holiday special on Assassin's Creed Valhalla. So if you enjoy Collateral Cinema and you enjoy video games as much as you do movies, then go check out Collateral Gaming Video Game Podcast, the sister podcast to Collateral Cinema. Yeah, I'm pretty much doing all the shit over there and doing all the editing and shit. And it's a good time.
Right on, man. Right on. And for Collateral Cinema, our next couple of episodes are going to be pretty interesting. Not only are we doing Mortal Kombat.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. But we're also doing a cross-cast for our Christmas episode with Victims and Villains. On our show, we're going to talk about Silent Night, Deadly Night Part 1. And for his show, we're going to talk about Silent Night, Deadly Night 2. You know, garbage day. That's shit. So that's going to be really, really fun. I'm really excited about that. And there's going to be more Director's Cut episodes as well. I think we're going to do a big indie movie episode for the Director's Cut here pretty soon. So stay tuned for that.
Hell yeah.
And you can find Collateral Cinema on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. You can find us on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Play, iHeartRadio, Chill Lover Radio, and wherever else you get your podcasts. Look for us on Patreon. We have tiers starting at $1 and also $5 tiers. We have fully featured commentaries there. And also, give us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts and on Podchaser, the IMDb of podcasts. We are on there, and that will help us climb the rankings a little bit. And also, leave us a comment and give us some feedback wherever you can, be it on social media or on your favorite podcatcher. So, with that, we're going to get out of here. I'm Bo Maddox.
I'm Ashley Chancellor.
No, you're not. You're biggest dickus, and that's what you're going to be from now on.
I'm Ashley Chancellor.
Biggest dickus.
And this was Collateral Cinema. Have a great day, everybody. Happy Thanksgiving.
Woo.
Life's a piece of shit when you look at it. Life's a laugh and death's a joke, it's true. You'll see it's all a show. Keep them laughing as you go. Just remember that the last laugh is on you. And
always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the right side of life.
Come on, boy, cheer up.
Always look on the right side of life. Always look on the right side of life.
First things happen to see, you know.
Always look on the bright side of life.
What you gotta lose? You know, you come from nothing. Are you lost? Nothing!
Look on the right side of life.
Nothing will come from nothing, you know what I say?
Always
cheer up, you old bugger. Come on, give us a quiz. There you are.
Life.
See? In the film. Incidentally, this record's available
always
in the foyer.
Look on the right.
Some of us
want
to live as well,
life.
You know? All right, it's a lot. Bernie, I said, they'll never make that money back.
Collateral Cinema is an L Company production. All music and movie clips are owned by the respective creators and are used for educational purposes only. Please don't sue us. We're poor.